Item number, SCP-008. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-008 samples have been deemed Class 5 extreme biological hazards, and all related protocols apply. Incineration and irradiation measures will be deployed in the event of political or military action, which may result in the facility being dismantled, a power failure, or zero communications from operatives or outside channels during any given 8-hour period. The quarantine period for operatives leaving the facility is 4 months. If a breach has occurred, incineration and irradiation measures shall be deployed. It should be the policy of all G2 sites to not prepare an evacuation procedure. Description: SCP-008 is a complex prion, samples of which are stored in each of the known G2 sites. Research into SCP-008 is highly classified, and primarily aimed at preventing research which may lead to the synthesis of SCP-008 in the distant future. Traits of the SCP-008 prion include 100% infectiousness, 100% lethality, transmission through exposed mucous membranes and all bodily fluids, not airborne or waterborne. Symptoms of infection with SCP-008 manifest no more than 3 hours after exposure, and include flu-like symptoms with high fever plus severe dementia in later stages, coma onset approximately 20 hours after first symptoms appear, and 12 hours after noticeable dementia. Coma onset will be considered onset of death. A period of sporadic cellular necrosis occurs, which comes to resemble gangrene. Surviving tissue assumes its original function and is highly resilient. Red blood cells greatly increase oxygen storage capacity, resulting in slower blood flow and increased muscle endurance and strength. Nervous and muscular systems are unaffected by total organ failure for several hours. Metabolism may decrease to extremely low levels, allowing subject to survive for over 10 years without nutrition. High blood viscosity results in negligible blood flow from gunshot, puncture, and slashing injuries. Conditioned behavior, motor controls, and instinctive behavioral mechanisms are damaged, and cognitive abilities are severely retarded and erratic. Animals experience excessive brain necrosis and are inactive. Subject can adapt to its damaged nervous systems but is limited to basic physical activities, including standing up, balancing on two legs, walking, biting, grabbing, and crawling. Subject will energetically move towards sights, sounds, and smells it associates with living humans. Subject will attempt to ingest living humans if physical contact is made. Neutralizing fully infected subjects requires significant cranial trauma. There is strong evidence to suggest SCP-008 itself did not form naturally on Earth, since variants of similar complexity would have displaced much of the ecosystem. In 1959, a short collaborative effort with the USSR to locate G2 sites and eliminate SCP-008 was negotiated following their discovery. The status of SCP-008 in Russian custody since collaboration ended is unknown. Addendum 008-1, SCP-500 has been found to be able to completely cure SCP-008, even in the advanced stages of the disease. Item number, SCP-16. Object class, Keter. Special containment procedures. SCP-16 is to remain within the confines of a 5x5x5 meter room at all times, maintained at a temperature not to exceed 0 degrees Celsius. SCP-16 itself is to remain in the petri dish in the containment cube at all times, unless directed otherwise by Level 4 or O5 personnel. Full documentation of experimentation with SCP-16 must be submitted before and after samples and duplicates of SCP-16 may be taken. Failure to follow these procedures will result in termination or reassignment as Class D personnel. Only authorized personnel may be permitted to obtain samples of and experiment with SCP-16 under BCL-5 containment conditions. If an outbreak does occur, despite following the aforementioned procedures, directive-based personnel are to implement a Code Sigma lockdown and containment plan. Infected personnel are to be terminated on site by security forces wearing standard mission-oriented protective posture, or MOPP, anti-biological and anti-chemical equipment. Should the infection not be contained after 48 hours, the on-site nuclear device is to be detonated. Remaining personnel are not to be evacuated under any circumstances. SCP-16 has been shown to survive for up to 6 hours on hard surfaces, and up to several minutes in air. High-intensity ultraviolet light and high concentrations of orthophthalaldehyde solution have been demonstrated to be effective in disinfecting non-organic surfaces. Description: SCP-16 is a blood-borne pathogen recovered from a mine worker and who injured himself while working in a deep coal seam. Said wound became contaminated with coal dust from the mine, possibly infecting the worker with dormant spores. Over the next several days, SCP-16 proceeded to infect the remaining employees at the mining camp, as well as the CDC crisis team dispatched to deal with the epidemic. Foundation personnel then took over the investigation and terminated all affected personnel. Patient Zero was brought into captivity, and the mine shaft was collapsed by an explosive device. SCP-16 has an incubation period ranging from 24 hours to 2 years, depending on the presence and number of other human hosts in the area. First symptoms resemble the common cold and include itchy eyes, runny nose, coughing, and bodily aches. Phase 2 begins in 48 hours and consists of a controlled form of hemorrhagic fever, as the organism causes a small amount of blood to become aspirated in the lungs, creating an aerosol effect. During Phase 3, the host crashes and bleeds out, bleeding profusely from every bodily orifice, including the nose, tear ducts, anus, skin pores, mouth, urethra, and in case of females, vagina. Blood pressure skyrockets during the final stage. Hosts have been observed projectile vomiting blood to distances of over 5 meters. Should the host survive this near-total exsanguination, the pathogen will become dormant once more, returning to incubation phase. What distinguishes SCP-16 from other strains of hemorrhagic fever, such as Ebola and Marburg, is its unusual response to high stress. Should the subject undergo a high-stress situation, such as a life-threatening crisis, the organism will change its survival tactic from rapid reproduction to the rewriting of the host's DNA and stimulation of rapid cell division. Major physiological changes occur within the first 24 hours, with complete bodily reconstruction occurring within 2 weeks' time. Most hosts do not survive the process due to the heavy demands made on the body. Due to their similarities as fatal contagions that stimulate the production of excess organs, a possible link to SCP-1801 is under investigation. An interesting side effect of the transformation is an increased aggressive urge. It is believed that this may be an attempt to maximize the spread of the virus in a manner similar to rabies. On another note, subjects who undergo bodily transformation no longer appear to exhibit SCP-16's hemorrhagic properties. However, subjects infected by transformed hosts will still undergo the normal SCP-16 infection process. Addendum: Experiment Log of SCP-16's Transformative Properties. Subject D-16-1. D-Class personnel infected by SCP-16. Upon first showing symptoms, subjects' quarters were slowly flooded with water over a 24-hour period. SCP-16 mutated into a teratomorphic state, transforming subjects' lungs into gills. Subjects survived for 2 more weeks as SCP-16 transformed its limbs into fins, caused its eyes to atrophy, and enhanced its sense of hearing into a Cetacean-type echolocation ability. Subject was terminated by draining all water from its quarters, causing it to asphyxiate. Body was subsequently cremated without autopsy. Subject D-16-2, D-Class personnel infected by SCP-16. Upon first showing symptoms, subject's quarters were slowly flooded with water over a 24-hour period. SCP-16 mutated into a teratomorphic state, causing subject to undergo rapid muscular growth and increased bone growth on knuckles. Subject then attempted to escape from confinement by punching through the reinforced steel door. Subject was not successful and died by drowning. Note: same situation, two different responses. Interesting. Dr. Subject D-16-3, D-Class personnel infected by SCP-16. Subject was previously a chemical engineer who poisoned his wife upon discovering her adultery. Upon first showing symptoms, subject's quarters were slowly flooded with water over a 24-hour period. SCP-16 mutated into a teratomorphic state, causing subject to grow an unusual organ on his chest, consisting of a chamber and two separate tubes. Organ continued to take in water and swell in size, until Foundation personnel, realizing what SCP-16 may be attempting, terminated the subject by gunshot. Organ was found to contain several gas sacs filled with acetylene gas and oxygen. Subject D-16-4, D-Class personnel infected by SCP-16. Subject was told to concentrate on forming wings. No stress was applied. SCP-16 did not mutate into teratomorphic state. Subject died of exsanguination during Phase 3. Subject D-16-5, D-Class personnel infected by SCP-16. Subject was told to concentrate on forming wings and placed in an acrylic box suspended 305 meters or 1,000 feet above a mine shaft. A timer was placed outside the box, which subject was told indicated the time to release. SCP-16 mutated into teratomorphic state, causing subject to grow a tentacle-like organ on his left wrist similar to a spider's spinnerets. Subject extended said organ through one of the box's air holes and extruded a strong, silk-like substance, which it then used to secure the box to the cable. Subject was terminated when the countdown reached zero, and the bomb detonated. Item number, SCP-20. Object class, Keter. Special Containment Procedures. Samples of SCP-20 are stored in a series of sealed cultivation chambers inside a sealed containment room at Biological Research Area 12, which is accessible only via airlock. Nutrients are administered via automated robotic systems, as the cultivation chamber must remain sealed at all times. Hermetically sealed video surveillance cameras are installed within the containment room and must be checked daily for integrity. Any personnel entering the containment room must wear biosafety level 5 equipment, including rebreathers, and undergo full antifungal disinfection upon exiting. Description: SCP-20 is a fast-spreading fungal organism that is capable of affecting the senses and behavior of living creatures, including humans. Samples of SCP-20 exhibit an unknown effect that renders them effectively invisible to direct observation, even when under a microscope. SCP-20 is only visible to humans when viewed through photographic or video surveillance. Once SCP-20 forms a colony, usually within a human residence, it will produce spores that affect the behavior of humans around it. Affected subjects will increase the heat and humidity within their homes to create an environment more suitable to the growth of SCP-20. Affected subjects also become more sociable in many cases, and often invite acquaintances to their homes to further spread the organism. As the spores and mold colonies are invisible to affected subjects, the mold may sometimes grow directly on living subjects. As the spores and colonies within a home approach critical concentration, the health of affected human subjects will rapidly deteriorate, resulting in death. Further spread of the mold may occur as the bodies of any deceased subjects are encountered by emergency responders and healthcare agents, as well as transportation of the bodies to local morgues. SCP-20 was first encountered in where an undercover SCP agent noted dramatic personality changes in personnel working at the local hospital. Upon investigation by a containment team, it was discovered that almost civilians had been infected, as well as a majority of the town. The civilian population was terminated, and the town incinerated under cover of a local flash forest fire. To date, over 12 outbreaks of SCP-20 have been reported. Investigations are currently underway to determine the source of these outbreaks and possible preventative measures. Addendum 20-01. Excerpts from the audio-video mission recorders of Mobile Task Force Ada 10, See No Evil. During the initial containment of SCP-20 on T2 lead, Team 2 moving to the Red House, T2 comm. Copy, UAV-1 is picking up one heat signature. T2 lead, Team 2 in place, ready to br- T2-2, door opening. At this point, a civilian woman appeared in the doorway, holding a kitchen knife. Video surveillance showed that nearly two-thirds of her face was covered by mold growths. Civilian woman: "Well, hello there, gentlemen. Care to take a breather inside?" T2 lead: "On the ground! Drop the weapon!" Civilian woman: "Don't be silly. Come on in and stay a while." T2 lead: "Stop where you are! Drop the weapon!" Civilian woman: We just want to have some guests. Please, come in." T2-2: "Drop that weapon!" It is assumed that at this point, the infected civilian noticed T2-4 carrying a primed incendiary weapon and lunged forward at the team members with the knife. Civilian woman: "Data expunged." T2 lead: "Open fire! Open fire!" Gunfire. Screaming. Item number: SCP-059. Object class: Keter. Special containment procedures: a single specimen of SCP-059 is kept at Site 11B inside a graded Z laminate shielding box composed of depleted uranium, tantalum, tin, steel, copper, and aluminum. Surrounding SCP-059's containment box is a 7-meter by 7-meter by 7-meter area, sealed as a level 4 biohazard area, and surrounded by 3 centimeters of lead shielding. This area is to be sprayed daily with a solution of methyl isothiocyanate to prevent overgrowth of SCP-059-1. Personnel entering an SCP-059 affected area are cautioned to wear appropriate biohazard protection, as well as type K-59-B radiation shielding. They are to remain in the area for no more than 15 minutes, as the radiation shielding is only partially effective. SCP-059-1 infestations found in the wild should be contained by removing the SCP-059 specimen responsible and incineration of all observed SCP-059-1. Large underground infestations are best neutralized by fuel-air thermobaric explosives. Additional specimens of SCP-059 are not needed for experimentation and should be transported to Site 11B for incineration by plasma arc at 10,000 Kelvin. Description: SCP-059 is a radioactive mineral of unknown origin, superficially resembling scheelite. A component of SCP-059 is believed to originate in an alternate universe, and to be responsible for its anomalous properties. In addition to alpha, beta, and gamma radiation, SCP-059 specimens produce a previously unknown type of radiation, apparently unique to the object, tentatively designated delta radiation. Delta radiation is accompanied by Cherenkov radiation, visible as a blue glow. Delta radiation is only partially contained by standard radiation shielding. The best results have been obtained using grade Z laminate shielding with an additional super dense metal layer. This reduces the effective range of delta radiation from approximately 20 meters to approximately 6 meters. When an area is exposed to delta radiation for more than 15 minutes, an unknown species of fungus, designated SCP-059-1, begins to grow on any exposed surface. This fungus does not require any standard nutrition, but will die within 24 hours of removal from a delta radiation source. SCP-059-1 is itself radioactive, but does not emit delta radiation. However, if a critical mass of SCP-051-1 is allowed to grow, delta radiation from an unknown source other than SCP-059 will appear in the area, further supporting SCP-059-1's growth. Interested readers may consult Dr. for his theories of space-time stress and merger of alternate realities. Within 18 hours, the infected mass will become transparent and disappear, presumably into the universe that is the source of delta radiation. The process then continues, with SCP-059-1 infecting new material. SCP-059-1 will infest both living beings and inanimate objects. Humans and animals infected with SCP-059-1 become immune to the effects of ionizing radiation, but progressively merge with SCP-059-1, and eventually have all tissues replaced by fungal growth. While generally non-violent, they will attempt to expose unaffected individuals to SCP-059. SCP-059-1 infections do not appear to be directly contagious, but only spread by contact with delta radiation. However, Long-term exposure to SCP-059-1 has not been adequately tested to rule out considering it a biohazard, as well as a known radiation hazard. Infected individuals still capable of communication describe seeing a world entirely covered with SCP-059-1, where much of the surface is composed of SCP-059. It is unclear whether this is a hallucination or a view into the source of SCP-059. Infectees are generally pleased with their condition and often refer to being in the blue light of heaven. SCP-059-1 is affected by most fungicides, but new growth will continue as long as SCP-059 is present. Early-stage SCP-059-1 infection in humans may be treated with griseofulvin. However, the treatment is 90% likely to lead to death by radiation poisoning. Treated individuals lose their immunity to radiation and will already have absorbed a now lethal dose prior to treatment. Late-stage treatment should not be attempted, as too much tissue will already be converted to SCP-059-1. The remains of failed treatments should be kept out of range of SCP-059. Otherwise, data expunged. SCP-059 specimens have been discovered in 8 different underground locations across a range of 5,000 kilometers. No pattern has emerged for their appearance. Specimens range from 1 to 10 kilograms in size and are not part of the normal rock formations in the areas where they have been found. Addendum. Dr. has recorded and analyzed the patterns of radiation emitted by the contained SCP-059-1 colony and believes SCP-059-1 may be sapient and attempting to communicate via controlled emissions of radiation. Initial attempts to analyze this language reveal data expunged. Item number, SCP-032. Object class, Euclid. Special containment procedures. SCP-032 is to be housed in Automated Containment Unit 535/15. Direct contact with SCP-032 is to be restricted to research-relevant tasks only. Interviews, if deemed necessary, are to be carried out using the unit's remote communication array. While SCP-032's presence is not directly harmful to the human body, exposure to it is to be limited to periods of 12 hours or less, due to its adverse effects on most beneficial microorganisms. SCP-032 is not to be exposed to any biological material not refined or otherwise tempered by humanity, with an emphasis on non-human living entities. SCP-032 neither requires nor requested substances or other forms of comfort. Description: SCP-032 is a Type F, imperfect external resemblance, internally inconsistent, human simulacrum of currently unknown origins. It is composed of an outer shell of pigmented silicone 5.5 millimeters thick and various plastic fiber polymers, with an outward appearance of a Caucasian woman nearing the third decade of life. SCP-032's interior is composed entirely of liquid refined oil, lacking any skeletal or muscle structure. Despite this, SCP-032 is capable of locomotion and speech. SCP-032 is capable of maintaining the illusion of humanity at a moderate distance, but becomes unconvincing at a closer range, causing mild discomfort in most observers. This effect has been deemed non-anomalous. Despite apparently possessing fully realized cognitive abilities, SCP-032 claims that it is not sapient, acting only as an intermediary instrument of its creators. The Foundation has not been able to verify or refute this claim as of yet. SCP-032 possesses extreme adverse effects to any biological entity in its close vicinity, not created, willfully influenced, manipulated by, or similarly relating to humanity. While the exact nature of these effects varies, SCP-032's presence inevitably causes severe and irreparable damage to the ability of any living organism to exchange and/or use energy. Wild flora loses its ability to photosynthesize or otherwise produce or consume energy, fauna the use of its respiratory and digestive systems, etc. This applies to microorganisms as well, though SCP-032's effects seem to favor damage to their reproductive systems instead. It is hypothesized that the symbiotic relation some microorganisms have to humanity is the reason for this discrepancy. SCP-032 was discovered sitting on the doorstep of the inner compound of Foundation Site near Slovakia. When questioned by Foundation security personnel, SCP-032 explained its anomalous effects and claims it was there to be stored. Surveillance footage show no record of the time of its arrival, and it is not yet known how SCP-32 came to know Site, its location, or approach it without being spotted. When asked for its reason for seeking Foundation custody, SCP-032 replied that it was there at the command of its creators, seeking indefinite storage until claimed. Addendum: Interview 032-A. Note: This interview was recorded near the time of SCP-032's initial containment by Dr. Alexander Kovach, Site resident psychologist, following its initial examination by Site security. Begin log. Dr. Kovach, before we begin, there's something I feel I should ask you, since security so often neglects doing so. It's not strictly conforming to protocol, but I find it tends to make things easier. SCP-032, I was instructed to cooperate. Dr. Kovach, good. Very good. Tell me then, what is your name? SCP-032, I don't have one. People have names. I'm not one. Dr. Kovach, is that so? What did your so-called creators call you then? SCP-032, they didn't. Dr. Kovach, surely they had to refer to you somehow. SCP-032, I am a vessel of their will and nothing else. They never needed to call. They never will. Dr. Kovach, in that case, would you mind if I refer to you as SCP-032? SCP-032, I was instructed to cooperate. Dr. Kovach, so you said. Tell me then, what is the purpose of your coming here? SCP-032, I am to be stored here until collected. Dr. Kovach, security told me that much, but why here, and collected by whom? SCP-032, collected by the ones they wish to torment, and stored here because in finding me here he will suffer further. Dr. Kovach, is that so? Is that person you refer to part of this organization, then? Do your creators bear some grudge towards a particular operative? SCP-032, he is not one of you, merely a one-time sympathizer of sorts. He believes you tried to help him once, and if he is forced here, if he finds me here, you will die. That will hurt him. They have no interest in any of you or your organization. You are here as a tool, just as I am. Dr. Kovach, who is this man then? What did he do to earn this sort of treatment from your creators? SCP-032. He did not know his place. Won when he should have lost, and was proud when he should have been humbled. Was wasteful with gifts too precious for abuse. Dr. Kovach, and you are here as punishment. SCP-032. He was already punished. Severely. Forced away from kin and kind, to endlessly wander, to destroy against his will. To poison humanity by his very presence. Eternal solitude, flavored by ceaseless guilt, a masterwork of torment, they say. Dr. Kovach, if that's the case, why are you here? SCP-032. Because even in this existence, there is the occasional moment of solace. At times, he may yet look to the world and see things he will not destroy, look to nature and feel warm wonder, and bask in the false light of ancient, moldy memories. It keeps him sane, gives him hope. That will not serve, hence my presence. I am to be his last undoing, a hastening to the end of reason. Dr. Kovach, and how will your presence do that? Are you meant to deceive him in some way? Is that why you look the way you do? SCP-032, in a manner of speaking, eventually, his wanderings will lead him here, to me, in a day, or a month, or a century, and he will recognize me. And see what they think of his precious memories. How they mock them. He'll understand that because of his actions, she is forever beyond his grasp. And all that remains to him is me. A simulacrum as artificial as his hope. When he finds me, I will attach myself to him, and he will watch the mockery of his memories destroy his last source of solace. And that will be that. Dr. Kovach, you said he will recognize you. Why? SCP-032. I used to be his wife. End log. Interview 032-B. Note: this interview was held 6 months following SCP-032's initial containment, as part of a series of interviews meant to evaluate SCP-032's cognitive abilities and personality, or lack thereof. Begin log. SCP-032. I hate her. Dr. Kovach. That's certainly a way to start an interview. Care to elaborate? SCP-032. The one I was made to look like. My mold. I hate her. Dr. Kovach. An interesting sentiment for you to have, considering your repeated assurance that you possess no consciousness or feelings of your own. SCP-032. I don't. I hate her because they want me to. It serves their purpose. Dr. Kovach, how do you get that impression? SCP-032. The first thing they did, after creating me, was to show her to me. It's not something they often do. Dr. Kovach, I don't follow. SCP-032. Interfere with those who passed beyond their halls. They might be vengeful, spiteful, even cruel, but they take their duties very seriously. Just to show her to me, to risk disturbing her final rest. They wouldn't do that without a purpose. Dr. Kovach, and SCP-032, she was beautiful, so peaceful, serene, whole, even gone, even dead. I could see the essence of who she used to be, of who she still was, and forever will be. Her soul. They told me she didn't get to live for all that long, but when she lived, she was herself. She was alive, and so I hated her. SCP-032, do you know what it feels like to be made as a mockery? In every line of that smooth, silent face, I saw a twisted reflection in my own. Fragrant skin to molded plastic, soft hair to synthetic fiber, blood to oil, soul to nothing at all. Dr. Kovach, excuse me if this sounds presumptuous, but I can't imagine feelings like this coming from anywhere but yourself. SCP-032 shakes head. Can't you see? This is all a part of their plan. When he finds me, when he sees what the brothers created just to punish him further, he'll go mad. Dr. Kovach, because of what they did to the memory of his wife. SCP-032, not only that, because he'll see me, he'll see how much I hate her. And how much I hate myself for not being her, hate being here at all. Dr. Kovach, and then what? SCP-032, then, a final realization. Dr. Kovach, and what would that be? SCP-032, he never won. End log.
Item number, SCP-088. Object class, safe. Special containment procedures. SCP-088 is to remain sealed in its airtight case at all times. The case is constructed of transparent acrylic plastic to resist the corrosive properties of SCP-088's secretions. In the event that SCP-088 should awaken from hibernation, any room that it is stored within should be constructed of durable plastics, rubber, or ceramics to hinder its ability to escape. Temperature of SCP-088's containment should not exceed 15 degrees Celsius, and any personnel entering containment must observe Level 4 hazardous material protocols and wear the appropriate protective gear at all times. Any personnel who do not observe proper containment protocols in presence of SCP-088, or who show signs of physical mutation, are to be demoted to D-Class and held for observation. Description: SCP-088 is a humanoid with reptilian features, which appear to have been mummified in a languid posture. However, SCP-088 is merely in a state of hibernation, from which it may recover if it is again exposed to a more hospitable environment than its current containment. Research has indicated that SCP-088 is approximately 6,000 years old, and is capable of secreting a variety of hazardous biological compounds from its mouth and hands. Some of these substances could be of great strategic value if replicated, but until a means to extract them without awakening SCP-088 is found, research into this area is on hold. SCP-088 was recovered with the mummified remains of 23 beings, sharing a similar morphology. However, none of these beings were alive, and examination suggests that they were originally human. information obtained by agents E-088-3 and E-088-7 and their subsequent mutation due to SCP-088 exposure corroborates this theory. Addendum. SCP-088 was recovered in 1931 from a subterranean complex below Los Angeles, California. The site was originally discovered by GWS using a device he called a radio X-ray, which was little more than a mechanical dowsing rod. While S's methods were dubious, his discovery was not. After mapping a series of tunnels and gold deposits below the city, S declared that he had found the lost city of the Lizard People, as described in the legends of Arizona's Hopi tribe. S's claims went as far as to be featured on the front page of the Los Angeles Times on January 29, 1934, before the Foundation was able to verify his claims and silence Mr. S. The subterranean complex was not nearly as extensive as described in legend, and most of the artifacts recovered within were too corroded to provide significant information, save for a long message carved into the rock wall of an unfinished tunnel. Containment Breach Overview. In more than 70 years of containment, SCP-088 has only roused from its state of hibernation twice, breaching containment with a caustic fluid that dissolves most minerals and metals. Each time, multiple personnel were exposed to a second compound, which SCP-088 uses to propagate itself. Affected personnel underwent a painful mutation, after which they shared the physical characteristics of SCP-088. Those few who received a large dosage of the compound, administered directly via mouth-to-mouth contact, were changed the fastest, and subsequently sacrificed themselves to protect SCP-088 from harm. SCP-088 has also demonstrated the ability to produce potent neurotoxins in liquid and gaseous form to combat containment personnel. Containment during the second breach was re-achieved by isolating SCP-088 and affected personnel in the facility and lowering the temperature. Affected personnel built a pedestal from discarded equipment, upon which SCP-088 took a recumbent position before slipping back into hibernation. The mutated personnel were neutralized at this point, and SCP-088 was returned to containment. The current strategy of lower temperature and non-metallic containment has been successful in keeping SCP-088 isolated. SCP-088 was reclassified to safe status on November 19.
Lesson complete. To continue with your orientation training, subscribe to SCP Orientation right now, and make sure you don't miss any of our upcoming videos.